Hallelujah.
Glory. Another page to my book. Come out of your sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, a sinner be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. You know what I mean? So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at his table, come taste of his grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow.
Invitation you extend not just to us but to the whole world to come as you are, and our hearts are especially burdened for what's going on in Eastern Europe there with between Russia and Ukraine, Lord. And Lord, we just ask that you would move mightily in that situation, move in the hearts and all the key players, Lord, as we gather. Lord, you call us to bear witness to the powers and principalities that you are the King of heaven and earth. Lord, you call us to worship you, and we cannot do it in our own strength. So pour out your Holy Spirit, fill us afresh, that we might truly worship you in spirit and truth. We ask it in your wonderful, precious name. Amen. Hey, take a seat. Number of things before we excuse the kids to children's church. And older kids, wait for me after the hymn. We'll go. Number one, we're continuing Sunday night. We'll be looking at this key passage in Galatians at the end of chapter 2 that Matthew will be teaching on this morning. Lots to process there. So if you want to do a deeper dive, I invite you to come out at 6 o'clock. We'll be meeting over in the Bible study room for some real good conversation and prayer as we meet with Jesus. Keep VBF in Valley Bible Fellowship in prayer as they're kind of seeking the Lord's direction. The notion that's cooking is that they're going to begin a Sunday evening worship service. So moving the Sunday morning to Sunday evening, so there'll be live preaching rather than video preaching. So keep that all in prayer. We think it's a great idea. It just opens up the morning completely to us. But we also think it's a great strategic move for VBF. So keep them in prayer. And Irene, you have a great Women of Grace. Where is she? There she is. a word of grace announcement. So Irene, come on up quickly, Irene. Yeah, Chad and Scott didn't realize, and Daryl, that they're joining Women of Grace this morning. We're going to initiate Chad and Scott and Daryl and the Women of Grace. There you go, Irene.
So I think you guys have all seen these guys down here probably every time you come down. They are always here. I called Scott yesterday because I didn't know if he was going to be back home. I said, Scott, where are you? I'm in front shoveling the church. You know, shoveling snow, shoveling ice, him and Daryl, Chad. We could not do this without them. These are our prayer angels, our church angels. These are
our church fairies.
Church angels. So we just wanted to appreciate them and show them how much we appreciate them. So we have gift certificates for Conan, for Daryl, Scott, and then Chad has Four Seasons because he loves that there. So, okay. So thank you guys for everything you've done for us.
All right. Yeah. Thanks, guys. Absolutely. You can. Yeah, please take your girlfriend. Hey, and finally, I wanted to share. I was praying actually Friday for how we might respond to the situation in Ukraine. And Karen and Noble sent me this link. Action, it's short for Action International Ministries. And it's a great way to, I will send everybody the link, the website, great way to support of the folks who are displaced by the, by Russians' incursion into the Ukraine. But just and what I really like about this, I just want to read a few paragraphs here. Chad, can you get that up to the Zoom on there? Dear missions-minded friends, none of us have been spared the emotional turmoil of watching the invasion of Ukraine. For Action's UK's new director, Paul Hughes, the events have created numerous sleepless nights and hours of phone calls to his best friends. Paul has been ministering in Ukraine since 2007 and is very well connected to several hundred churches there, is therefore spearheading Action's immediate response to this humanitarian crisis. And then Paul Hughes writes this, over recent weeks, we have been preparing the way to accommodate 300 to 500 internally displaced persons in Ukraine within a safe network of churches in conjunction with national, regional, and local church leaders. We have a history of many years of fruitful and accountable gospel partnership with these networks. Then he writes, it breaks our hearts to see what our precious friends are going through. What I like about the opportunity is that it is profoundly local, close to the ground, working through the local church in the Ukraine to provide not only a material support, but of course, what's even more important is the power of international fellowship that Action International Ministry represents, and of course, the work of prayer. So I'll be sending everybody a link. If you can't wait for the link, it's actioninternational.com, I think. Wait for the link. Is that it? Great, Karen. Karen has a flyer out there. So, man, I encourage you to give and to give generously. I mean, you can imagine the sudden dislocation that folks are experiencing. What an opportunity to draw near to the Lord and bring our concerns to him. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful. Our hymn is hymn number 43, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Oh. Encourage you to keep in prayer Hollis Kimbrough IV, who's in Romania. I asked Hollis this morning what his job is. He's essentially, he's second lieutenant. He's attached to headquarters with the NATO contingent there. Just the tactical something or just ready to move in whatever emerges. So keep Hollis in prayer. Matthew, come in. Kids, we are excused.
From the Lord. All right, thank you. All right, good morning, everybody. Is there a word from the Lord today? Anybody on some sort? Awesome. You want to come on up? I got the microphone for you. Amen. We got notes and everything. All right.
First, I'd like to thank those who came out for our cleaning yesterday at church. Irene, Terry and Kathy Flynn, Daryl, Elliot, Ricky, Chad, and me. Amen.
I can get your hands here. What do you want?
Thank you. Hold that for me. Thank you, sir. I just have a word, and it's about faith. In my daily devotions on the 21st, I read about Lord God asking, this is from Exodus 3:7-10 and 4:10-15. And God is asking Moses to lead his people out of Egypt. And Moses tries to get out of it. He gets out and tries to get out of leading the people out of Egypt. But at the end of my devotion, there's some questions. When have you felt incapable or ill-equipped for a task or role you felt God calling you to fill? How did God help you? Well, that was when I lost my husband. It'll be 3 years in May. And I want to tell you, if it wasn't for God, I wouldn't be here. So keep the faith.
I think that might be good. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, what a beautiful reminder. But I think most of us could wake up any day, and if we really estimated honestly the task that stood before us, we would quickly recognize that we're not up there. And the things that we've been called into are well beyond our strengths to meet them. And Lord, in that, would we find that your strength is made perfect in our weakness? And I thank you for that reminder, and not just for us as individuals, but collectively as your church, Lord. We recognize the faults and flaws in the body as it is right now. And would that be a word to call us together to recognize that my limitation might be my brother and sister's strength, and that we desperately need one another. And even in a larger consideration, Lord, we look at the whole world and we recognize the darkness and the brokenness that pervades the world all around us is in desperate need of the light that comes only from you. And that's what you've called us to be, your light in this world of darkness. So Lord, would you stir that up in us this morning? Would you fuel us with your word and with your spirit? Would you get me out of the way and just help us all to hear what we need to hear from you, and not just hear it and not just understand it, but go from this place and live it out. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. All right. Now I'm switching, Chad.
All right. Irene's prayers were just answered. She prays for me every Sunday that I preach that I'm going to get through the technology bit. We're doing great so far. We got one more button, actually, Irene. Don't quit praying just yet. Now I got an echo. Share my screen and then we'll keep going. Chad, do you hear that little echo? This one off? What do I do? Okay. Well, I kind of like the Grand Canyon. Okay. We there? Good. Yeah, I'm off audio here. I think it's from this one. But it is muted. Go with it. What if I stand further away? No, then I'm out of the camera. It doesn't matter. All right, everybody. We're not going to worry about that. Irene, just keep praying. No. All right. This morning, we're going to be in Galatians 2, 15 through 21. As Kyle's already kind of hinted, I don't think he was, throwing me under the bus here, but he said, this is a complicated passage. And you probably won't get it from what I'm saying. So you should come back at 6 o'clock tonight and walk through it with a group of people. But I will just echo that it is dense. It is rich. It's full of good stuff. And it is well worth spending more time with. I've been with it all week. And I know I'll be going back. So I'll just say that. But let's hear from the word directly. Again, this passage in Galatians. We are Jews by nature, and not sinners from among the Gentiles. Nevertheless, knowing that man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Christ Jesus, even we have believed in Christ Jesus so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. Since by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. But if, while seeking to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have also been found sinners, is Christ then a minister of sin? May it never be. For if I rebuild what I once destroyed, I prove myself to be a transgressor. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died needlessly. Pretty rich, good, right? I could probably just sit down now. We could just stay in silence for the next 25, 30 minutes and reread that. It might not be the worst idea, but Tony pays me the big bucks to talk. So here we go. I think one thing that's been really helpful for me since diving into the Galatians, and probably going back further than that, probably since meeting Kyle and walking through the Bible with him, is just the idea of learning to read the Bible well. And I'll introduce this word, just reading the Bible through the right paradigm. That is kind of the right lens, the expectations of the Bible that we might not even realize we have, but the way we approach God's word. And I'm going to commend to you some work from an organization called the Bible Project. Some of you are familiar with them. They create those little 5 to 10 minute short videos explaining books of the Bible, themes of the Bible, words in the Bible. And they have a whole app now with podcasts. There's a great one called The Bible Paradigms. I think it's 10 or 11 podcasts long. I've listened to all of them. My wife is very excited that I've spent 12 hours listening to podcasts. But let me not stop there. There's another one called How to Read the New Testament Letters, also about 12 hours of podcast. Guess what? I've listened to all of those. Again, my wife's very excited. She thinks I'm out doing things in a yard in the garage, but you know, you'd think my house would be really organized, but it's not. But those are very helpful, but I'm going to try to distill some of those thoughts from those resources here today, because for me, they've been really helpful, again, specifically as we approach Galatians. But this is kind of thinking about the Bible as a whole. I think for some of us, we kind of operate with a paradigm that the Bible is a theological textbook, right? We open it up, and we can think about things like justification or predestination or election, or you name it, right? And then we go to that Bible and we start looking for the verses that either support or defend or refute or whatever it is, right? And so we're picking and choosing, and we're going through and we're looking for kind of evidence to back a claim or refute a certain claim, almost reading it like a lawyer would go through a document, looking for something to support or defend a case, right? Another way that we might approach the Bible is as a moral handbook, right? So what's right and what's wrong and how should I go about it? Or maybe we're not really that interested in applying that to ourselves, but we got some naughty little kids. So we're like, I'm gonna crack the Bible open and I'm gonna show you what's right from wrong, right? So we look at it that way. Or maybe a third way would be kind of the devotional, what I'm calling the devotional grab bag, right? So things have been a little rough. Bad day at work, argument with a friend, something like that. I know what I had to do. I had to crack my Bible open, just flop it to a page. The Psalms are pretty reliable usually. Ooh, not that Psalm. It's asking to smite an enemy. I'll flip to another Psalm, right? Ooh, that one makes me feel warm and fuzzy. Good. I'm ready to go on my day. Now, let me not criticize these too much. The Bible, just to be clear, is full of amazing theology. It's where we should get our theology. Right? The Bible also teaches us a lot about right and wrong. It does through the context of story and narrative and specific times and places and people, but it's certainly where we want to draw our definitions of right and wrong. And our Bible is a wonderful place, and I do this every morning, to spend time and devotion and to feel the presence and peace and power of the Lord. So I'm not against any of those things necessarily, but the Bible's more than that, okay? And when we reduce it to one of these kind of utilitarian views, when we're treating it like a reference book that, hey, it's gonna do some things for me. Either it's gonna answer my question so I can go argue with this guy at the coffee shop, or it's gonna teach me right and wrong so I know how to, you know, deal with my boss who's a jerk, or it's gonna, you know, just make me feel warm and fuzzy on a cold day. Again, it has the potential to do those things, but do you see I'm using the Bible there rather than entering into the Bible, rather than letting the Bible and particularly God's Spirit at work through the Bible work in me. And so maybe a little bit more way helpful to look at the Bible, and this is a line from the Bible Project. This is their little tagline. Is that it's a unified story that leads to Jesus. I think that's beautiful. If you don't take anything else from today, I got all kinds of stuff going on now, Chad. Echoes. Okay. Pretty loud, too. They said take the delay off. That the Holy Spirit just told me that. Or maybe it was Jerry. Okay. A unified story that leads to Jesus. That feels better. It sounds better. And I'll give you an alternative one. I've seen a little bit about it. Because unified story, I think, is great. Every book points to Jesus in its own way. But one thing I think is that we recognize that it's a diverse literary library, right? So there's history. There's poetry. There's prose discourse or rhetoric involved. There's a lot of different types of literature included in the canon or the library that is the Bible, but it's all centered on not the idea of Jesus. Do you hear what I almost did there? On Jesus, the person, the Lord Jesus. So let me be clear about that. So I want to challenge us just a little bit to kind of think of the Bible and how we read it, how we approach it. and maybe rethink some of the paradigms, the ways we go about looking at the Bible. So let's take a little bit deeper dive into this. Now, we talked about this last time I was up, right? And that is, we can think of the Bible as kind of four major themes or four major ideas, and they happen in order, but they also happen within the course of the Bible. So we get creation, right? God makes all things, and it's very good. There's this fall, sin enters in. God invites people into a partnership with him. He invites them to be fruitful and multiply, to align their will to ours. But we think, you know what? Maybe we have better ideas. Maybe we'd like to try out some things. Things go sideways at that point. God doesn't say, "Oh, told you so," and wash his hands of it. He instantly launches a rescue mission and says, "I'm going to redeem you." And it might not be pretty, but I'm not going to stop. And we call that next phase redemption, right? And we see that in its completeness, in its fullness, in the person of Jesus, whose life, death, resurrection, and reign redeems us. But that actually isn't the final act either, because we get this idea of restoration, of reunified heaven and earth, so that heaven isn't this escape hatch that we fly out of one day, but God actually returns. And heaven and earth are reunited as they were at the beginning. And his will is done on earth as it is in heaven, right? That's, we talked about kind of this fuller framework of the Bible. We talked about how that aligns beautifully with what we've been referring to as the full gospel, right? And we talked about how we can kind of get stuck in the middle there. We can get stuck on Jesus died and Jesus rose. So I'm a sinner. Jesus died for my sin. He rose again. I'm going to heaven. Period, right? But again, it's this fuller, richer story. Jesus came, he re-enters into creation, right? And we see the Son of God, the Son of Man in one, this divine human partnership at work in the world as it should be. He's a perfect representation of a genuine human. He's the image of the invisible God here on earth. He does die to deal with the square just above it, that fall, that sin. There's a price that justice demands be paid for that, right? But it's not over there. He rises again. He defeats death. And in that line right there in between the two, we recognize that the age has shifted. And this present evil age has been defeated. And the age to come has been inaugurated at the cross. And Jesus now reigns over his kingdom. Think of the sermon he preached over and over again when he was here on earth. The kingdom has come near. And as his sons and his daughters, we are invited to live into that kingdom, not someday, but now. But now. And you know what we call that? It's because it's not by our own strength, our own might, our own will, our own volition, our own grit. It's by his power at work in us through the Holy Spirit. And we say, Jesus reigns for that reason. Are you with me? Okay. So now, I just learned how to do tables in Google Slides. Can you tell? I got three of them in here. I'm very excited. This took me 3 hours to build this slide. This is what life is like for an English major. But I was still very proud of myself. The compositional structure of the Bible. So this kind of fits in the same framework, right? But just the way our Bibles are built, we have the Torah, we have the prophets. Torah sometimes referred to as the law because we hear Jesus talk about the law and the prophets, right? And then we have what Bible scholars refer to as the writings. This would include the Psalms and some of the smaller letters and things like that. And then we have the Gospels, right? And we can see, again, if you're looking up and down the slide there, yeah, I see creation and I see fall and I begin to see redemption. There's a structure there. And we could probably stop right there and recognize, man, we have four movements of the story and really kind of a lot of what we need to know. We have God's original design. It points forward. We see the mistake, the fall, the sin that breaks it up. We see God launch that rescue mission, particularly through the people of Israel, through the person of Abraham. We see that advance despite people messing up and falling off and going sideways and being stiff-necked, as it says in the Bible, right? Jesus, or God, just keeps coming after us and coming after his people and rescuing his people until he finally sends Jesus. And there's that promise that's fulfilled at that moment, the promise that was actually first given to Abraham, that you'll be blessed so that all nations will be blessed through you. And Jesus in that inaugurated kingdom is the fulfillment of that promise. Israel, you kind of held the ball. You kind of kept it together. You got it down the field, but it was never for you alone. It was to bless all nations. And when we see Jesus go to the cross, when we see Jesus leave that empty tomb, and we see Jesus in glory, we recognize that that blessing is not just for Israel anymore, but for all people. And that gets us really close, actually, what Paul's talking about in this letter. And it brings us to where we are in these little squares, right? To the letters. The letters, after this story has been told and it reaches its fulfillment in the person of Jesus, which we know through the Gospels, now we get to this interesting place in the Bible, the letters, right? And so here's people that know the story. They've either entered it real early, like Paul, who was a Pharisee among Pharisees, or they've entered it pretty lately, like some Gentiles that just encountered the risen Christ. But they've become aware of the story. And now in the letters to these early churches, we see people equipped with this, again, more than understanding, but this reality that Jesus reigns, that Jesus has defeated death, and this new kingdom is now available to us. We've been invited into it. How are we going to make that work? And guess what? It's not easy. And so Paul has to write an awful lot of letters, along with Peter and a few others, right, to try to begin to sort this out. Now, notice there's a little blank there, the sixth movement of what we might think of in this story. Guess what that is? That's us. That's the time we're living in right now. Guess what? Our problem is very similar to the ones that were being worked out by Paul and the other apostles in those letters. We know the law. We know the prophets. We have these other beautiful writings. We have the gospel. Again, the whole story really centers on that, on the person of Jesus. We have these early letters of people trying to solve some problems and work things out. We also know how the story ends. But we live in this little sixth movement in between, where we too, not unlike those apostles, not unlike Paul and Peter, are trying to figure things out between the kingdom come near and the kingdom fulfilled, as we'll see one day, heaven and earth reunited. Does that help us a little as we kind of think about this biblical context? And just know that where we're going to be working today is in those letters. So for me, it's helpful to kind of position myself in that. All right. So a couple thoughts about letters. Don't worry, I'm going to start preaching the sermon any minute ago. Now, this is just the introduction, but what does Kyle call these extended introductions? Something about these letters that we're reading. They really are real letters. Something to be aware of. And what are we getting at best in a letter? Half of a conversation, right? There is a real writing process. I forget what episode it is of one of those podcasts, but there's a great deep dive into how these letters were composed, and it involved scribes, and it took place over multiple drafts, and they would paid somebody who had really neat small handwriting because parchment paper was expensive and you wanted to try to jam as much on there as you could. And then once in a while, like at the end of this letter, Paul would sign his big messy hand over the top of it. So see, I signed it with my own hand so you can see it. But that would have cost extra money because, you know, there might have just been an inch or two left on the papyrus. And there's a whole thing that's going on there. And Paul probably had other notebooks on wax frames that he would have kept some pre-formed material in, because we see some of the same ideas and language even show up throughout Paul's letter. That might have been something Paul kind of had ready to go, right? And he would have handed it to a scribe. There are real recipients to these letters. These early house churches that, again, have come to recognize Jesus as their Lord, and yet they got to get along with people who they didn't talk to 2 weeks ago. And not only that, they're operating in this political pressure pot, and this cultural and ethnic division, and they've got problems they've got to work out. Real problems, division, disunity. And of course, these letters are real important, I put here, because they're working out what it means to live in Christ in this whole new reality. And for us, there's some real work to do here. And back to what we started about a few minutes ago, because I think we need to discard some of these unhelpful or less helpful paradigms where we just go to a book like Galatians and we go, I want to pull out an argument on predestination, right? I'm gonna find out what the church should be doing right and what the church has been doing wrong, or what my kids have been doing right or doing wrong, right? Or I'm just gonna read Galatians and try to feel good, you know, because it's been hard lately. It's not so much that we really have to discard these paradigms and try to crawl back into that world of Paul. All right, how am I doing on time? Terrible. I do have a short little thing to help us demonstrate how letters might work. I have my first volunteer, who's Tony Rubino, and all he has to do is sit there. But I need a second volunteer who's brave and willing to read slightly messy handwriting out loud. Is that you, Irene? Come on up. Okay. Now, I think, well, how should we do this? Yeah, I think for the sake of the folks at home, I'm going to have you read this from up here. But what I'm trying to model is I've written a letter to Tony, okay, who's, you know, a member of the Church of Cachapia, right? And I'm sending this letter through my trusted helper, Irene. Okay, I'm going to give you a microphone, and I'm going to hope that nothing explodes when I hand you this over my microphone. How are you doing with that handwriting? I should have typed it, right? I'm a scribe. All right, go ahead.
Is this on? Okay.
Yeah.
Trout dog, Toby here. Peace and grace to you. I am encouraged by the gathering of the King's men, sacred marriage, men and boys, and more to come. Are you getting this, trout dog? That first Saturday taught some lessons for big guys. One little stove, may it never be. Onward burritos next week. Opening day isn't far away now. Perhaps we will find our way to Furnace Creek soon with time to test that Panther Martin number 9. Blessings, Matthew.
Good, thanks. All right, a couple questions. Tony, did you understand that? Did that make perfect sense to you? Were any of the rest of you confused by the introduction of Trout Dog? Okay, Tony's secret nickname when he's up in the Eastern Sierra slaying trout. Tony likes to tease me that I look like Toby Mac, which I don't. But Toby here, right? Now, I actually move into a paragraph on ministry, right? The King's Men. I didn't know until like 2 weeks ago that's what we call the group of men that gather here on Saturday mornings to eat breakfast. Apparently that's a term that's been around a while, right? Can you imagine 2,000 years from now, someone finds this letter and is going, who are these King's Men, right? We need to have a King's Men at our church, right? And maybe they do. They certainly need bacons and burritos. But again, I've used a book title here, Sacred Marriage. I didn't put it in quotations or anything, but that's a book title. Men and Boys, that's an event. More to come. Taught some lessons here. Talk about the little electric stove and how poor Pat Neisler and I had to try to share elbow space and cook bacon and hash browns and eggs all at the same time, right? We've solved the problem, a practical problem with burritos. And then I daydream about going fishing with Tony up in Bishop, right? And I end it with this Panther Martin number 9. That's Henry or Tony's favorite little fishing lure. But can you imagine, again, 2,000 years from now, Dan Brown could write a book, you know, called Panther Martin number 9, Angels and Demons or something. You know, this could be the code that unlocks everything. All I'm suggesting is when you're dealing with letters, especially written by two people with a relationship with one another, we have to have a little humility, right? And again, I'm not trying to cast doubt in any way on the letters of the New Testament, but I'm trying to cultivate appreciation for the context, for the complexity, and really the richness of what we're diving into, which I have 3 minutes to do. Here we go. Oh, I got more context. Gosh, I'm never gonna get started. The specific context of these letters to the Galatians, just to pay attention here, we have a Jewish messianic movement, right? So we have the Jews that have indeed come to believe that Jesus is Lord. Conversely, we have Jews that still reject Jesus as Messiah. That complicates things a little bit. We have Gentile believers, right? those who are not part of the story or history or people of Israel, uncircumcised, unkosher, people that are out doing stuff on the Sabbath, right? But they've come to believe that Jesus is Lord. And on opposite of them, we have Gentile idolaters who still reject Jesus as Lord. It's important to know that this is all happening within the context of Roman rule. If you're a Roman, you're required by law to worship and offer sacrifices to Caesar. Unless you're a Jew, there's a little exception carved out for you where you can offer sacrifices on behalf of Caesar, but not to Caesar. Now you can imagine some of these new Gentiles showing up and saying, oh, I don't have to offer sacrifices to Caesar anymore because I believe in Jesus now. And you can imagine the Jews getting nervous saying, hey, you're going to mess up this deal we have with the Roman authorities. You get it? Roman rule really represents this present evil age. And Paul, again, is just trying to remind this early church, hey, there's a whole new reality. You're operating down here, and we need to be operating up here. And the key question, and this is going to sound different depending on how you've approached Galatians in the past, perhaps, is who is part of this kingdom and how can we tell? Notice I didn't say who's getting into heaven and how. So who's a part of this kingdom and how can we tell? All right, it's been a long time since I read the passage, but there it is again. I'm not going to reread it because we're a little short on time, but I am going to start diving in and try to go as quick as I can, verse by verse. We're going to be 5-10 minutes over. Good luck, Sunday school teachers. First line, first verse. We are Jews by nature and not sinners from among the Gentiles. What we want to hear there is there are two distinct categories, Jews and Gentile sinners. Now, we look upon that with kind of moral judgment. We think righteous Jews, Gentile sinners, good and bad. Now, there would have been an element of that, but really this was about a group identity. This is not so much about good and bad or moral distinctions as two totally different people types, more of us and them. So it's the people of God who are just born into it by circumstance and begin to learn a way that they've practiced now for generation after generation. And then these others who, again, by circumstances, were not born into that family. And so they lived a life of patterns and bondage to idols, which we would characterize as sin. But this isn't just thinking of the guilty and the innocent. This is really two different groups of people that Paul's addressing. You Jews with your story and you Gentiles with your story. I'm talking to both of you here because we have a practical problem. He says, nevertheless, knowing that man is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law, since by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified. Okay, again, if we're stuck in that moral framework, we're imagining this court case going on where Jews stand before a judge and they're found righteous or innocent, and Gentile sinners are found guilty for what they've done. It's something different than that, right? It's something fuller and richer than that. Again, you have two people groups with their own story, but now they've been brought together by faith in Christ. And not just brought together, they've been declared righteous. And that's different than being declared innocent. This word, dikaiosyne, which I just slaughtered, but Kyle will teach you how to say it next week, means more than just innocent. It means in right relationship with God. It means forgiven and given a place in God's family. And the result of that is a transformation by grace. Do you see that? This is a difference between, again, if we wanted to go back to the courtroom thought for a second, this is the difference between being accused of a crime and being found innocent, where you walk out free and you're all by yourself, you can do whatever you want now because you got your ticket to heaven, versus a court proceeding that finalizes an adoption. Welcome to your new family. Here they are. Go live with them. You see the difference in that? That's what it means to be declared righteous. You've been brought into a family. You have a father. You have brothers, you have sisters, live here, learn to live with us. It's going to take a while, but we're going to work it out. And how does this come about? It comes about by faith. And again, we think of faith as kind of an idea, a mental abstraction. I believe, I think a certain set of ideas are true. That's my faith. But it really is more than that. The original word would have been pistis, which is closer to an idea of allegiance. And so it's less an abstraction and more an embodied reality. It's not just something I think or conceive or understand. It's something that governs the way I live my entire life. And when you add these things together, this, I don't even want to say the word, being declared righteous plus this faith, pistis, plus the kaisene, right? What do you get? You get this distinct community, this covenant community where a faithful king and his faithful people partner together. Does that sound a little like Genesis? Does that sound a little like the founding of Israel? Does it sound a little like Acts 13 where the church breaks out, right? This is what we've always been called to. And this is why Paul's addressing these two groups, this us versus them type of dynamic, and saying, no. It's not because of your story. It's not because of your background. It's not because of what people group you used to belong to. It's you have been declared righteous by faith. And that has ushered in an entirely new reality, a kingdom where Jesus reigns. Tim Mackey, the guy who's the head of the Bible Project, says it like this. When people trust in the Messiah, Jesus, what's true of him becomes true of them. His life, death, and resurrection becomes their life, death, and resurrection. It's good, right? Let's keep marching. Verses 17 through 19, little bend through the woods here, but stay with me. But if we, while seeking to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have also been found sinners, is Christ then a minister of sin? May it never be. For if I rebuild what I once destroyed, I prove myself to be a transgressor. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. All right, we got to back up here a little bit and kind of locate what Paul is talking about here in the story of Acts that we get in the Luke Acts series, right? There was a time when Peter, right, had the vision and he recognized that anything that God has created cannot be unclean, and he eats with Gentiles. He says, hey, we can do this because we understand that Jesus reigns and we are now one new community, one new kingdom community under his rule. But then the people of James, as they're called, or James's people, who are more Jewish in their bent, come down and go, wait, this can't be enough. Plus, there's that whole deal with Rome. We got to be a little more careful about this. Let's get these guys circumcised. Let's teach them how to be kosher, and let's make sure they're observing the Sabbath, right? And Peter gets a little spooked and goes, yeah, maybe that's a good idea. And he stops eating with the Gentiles. And this is when Paul shows up. This is what we read last week. Paul's ticked, right? And says, I can't believe you've forgotten this so quickly, this new reality. But he's pointing out here, Jesus wouldn't have tricked us into that table fellowship once, only to change course and say, hey, you know, we got to bend these guys back to not only being Jesus followers, they got to be Jews and Jesus followers as well, right? So Paul debunks that. And then notice this clever little move Paul makes in 1:18. He's been using you and we and all these other pronouns, but here he says, for if I rebuild what I once destroyed. Paul kind of takes ownership of the idea. He's not pointing fingers here. He's saying, if I did this, I would be wrong. And so if you're his listener, you're not on the defense anymore. You're following Paul through his argument. It's pretty smart, right, rather than point a finger. And then he says, for through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. And again, we might kind of have that courtroom scene in our head, but think of law there, not so much as law as Torah or the story, kind of what we talked about when we talked about biblical context. And what we know in that is that whole story of what we think of as the Old Testament pointed and delivered us to Jesus. For through the story, I died to the story so that I might live to God, because the Bible is a story that leads us to Jesus. You see that? Paul's just recognizing this messianic story the whole Old Testament has led us to this moment that has been fulfilled in Jesus. We didn't come to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. Verse 20, this is the one. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I really don't need to preach that, right? It preaches itself. That's about as clear a distillation of the gospel, the life of Christ, as we're going to get. But maybe to point out just a few things. Whatever other identity, Jew, Gentile, Democrat, Republican, white, black, whatever it is, whatever other identity I might be tempted to live out of is now gone. It is no longer I who live, but it is the Spirit of Christ, Christ that is alive and lives in me. Yes? A couple ways we hear this again in the letters of Paul, so some echoes and then also some implications. In Philippians, Paul says kind of a similar thing, but in a little different way. I just want you to hear both side by side. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as lost for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be lost in the view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. And I count them but rubbish so that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness, the family, which comes from God on the basis of faith, that I may be know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, in order that I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Same idea, a little different angle, and then some implications. This is really where it lands for me right now. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Remember why Paul was writing this letter. He had Jews and Gentiles who couldn't get along. And he's reminding there's a whole new reality. So again, just again, to remember where and why Paul was reading this letter, right? It's to these house churches of Galatia. It's to these divided people. It's where this other gospel is afoot, that it's not just enough to believe in Jesus. You need to believe in Jesus and do a few more things. And Paul's discounting that and debunking that. He's coming at it pretty hard. Another thing you learn if you study these letters, there was a very clear format Paul wrote whenever he starts his letters. He always starts with a greeting, and then he gives a prayer of thanksgiving for the people. Do you know what the one exception is? Galatians, no prayer of thanksgiving. Greeting, next paragraph, I am astounded that you have so quickly forgotten the gospel you once knew. He's not thankful. He's ticked off. But why is he ticked off? Because he wants them to remind them of what the true gospel is and what it is doing and ought to be doing in our real and actual lives. And that's what Paul's talking about in this letter. And I think that's what lands us into that blank square where we're at right now, trying to figure out really some of the same problems in a new context with new names, but a similar task. In this reality, this is from N.T. Wright, the crucified Jesus has been raised from the dead, launching God's new creation of which he is Lord. That's what we're trying to figure out. That's what we're living in. That's what we're trying to be faithful to. So I'm running out of time here, but I do want to land this somewhere closer to where we live. I want us just to consider our time. I'm not going to go on and on about this, but Paul's identified this temptation in two categories. For the people he's writing to, it's righteous Jews and Gentile sinners. That probably doesn't resonate too much with us, but I think we have to recognize the temptation of two categories. And the most basic one that all of us are easily prey to is us and them. We get it, they don't. I'm just going to name one, left and right. We have watched it tear apart our country, tear apart our families, tear apart friendships, and particularly over these last couple years. And as we pray for the people of Ukraine and we watch some of these things unfold in the world around us, you know, we could acknowledge East and West, again, as a division that's opening up. Maybe there's another category for you that you go, man, my heart tends to do this. I think it's just something to hold and consider as we recognize that we're seeing asked that same question that Paul was asking, who is part of God's kingdom and how should we know them? And I just want to be clear about this, that it's not by particular practices. It's not by political alliances. It is by pistis, this robust, embodied faith that we have become members of the family of God, not because of what we have done or what we're doing, but by what he has done for us. And that gift that we talked about on the first week we talked about Galatians invites our response. It's not the Christmas gift that we give our kids that's broken in the yard 3 days later. It's a precious gift that invites a gift in return our whole lives. And the idea that still captures that best for me is that word Shema, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, and we shall obey him with all our hearts and minds and souls. There's not a Jewish word for listen and a separate word for obey. Listen and obey are the same Shema. It's a totality of response. But for us, I wanted to extend a few invitations. Notice what I've done here. I've taught a long lesson, and now I'm assigning homework. It's a habit that's been ingrained over me for 22 years. But I didn't call it homework. I call it invitation because I'm not going to check if you did it next week. But I'd love to hear the story if you did. So here's the first one. I did this week. Sit down and read Galatians as a letter in one go. And if you feel comfortable doing it, read it out loud. It'll just change the way you see Galatians. Really get that in your head, kind of some of the things we talked about today. It's a letter. It's written to a group of people. It's written by a guy, probably surrounded by a few other of his people. It's a letter. And then for those of you familiar with the discipled by Jesus model, you'll recognize the language here, but this is a great way to sit with a letter once you've read the whole thing in its entirety. Just listen for the voice of Jesus and answer these questions as Jesus asked him of you. Who do you say that I am? Do you understand what you've done for me? Are you listening to me? Do you love me? If so, how does that turn into feeding my sheep? Do you believe me? Great questions just to sit with when we sit with a good chunk of scripture like that. That's the easy one. That's for the academics, that invitation. You should all be able to check that off your list by Wednesday. Here's a harder one. Consider the inclination of your heart toward those two categories, whatever those two categories are for you. And maybe you've got six sets of two categories. I don't know. Maybe I do. Maybe I'm talking to myself. I think the first thing we need to do is to simply, these are old-fashioned churchy words, but here they are. Confess that sin to the Lord. Say, Lord, I've divided my thinking into us versus them, left versus right, black versus white, east versus west, whatever it is. Confess it. Repent of it. Meaning, I was walking this way, but I'm going to turn. I'm going to walk a new way. And in as much as it's up to you, seek restoration. Is there a phone call to make? Is there a text message to send? Is there someone to meet for coffee? Still with me? One more verse. I wasn't going to shortchange you. Verse 21. I do not nullify the grace of the Lord. For if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died needlessly. Paul just draws it all home, right? Here's that word grace, which we again thought of as gift when we started Galatians, and it's that gift that invites that rich response. There's righteousness to be declared righteousness, not just found innocent, but to be brought in a relationship with God, to be forgiven and given a place to his family that results in our transformation through grace. How does this come about? By our faith. Less about an idea and more about a total embodied reality. And what does that all add up to? Well, let's be clear about this. Christ did not die needlessly. And we know the full gospel. Christ came, Christ lived, Christ died, Christ rose, Christ reigns. And he's done that. That is the gospel. It is finished so that we, his people, can live in love, in partnership, in relationship, with an intimate day-to-day reality with our great God. And that we can become the genuine human beings we were made to be, that we were called to be, that we see perfectly represented in Christ. And that day by day, as we enter into this entirely new reality, and we walk in it, we love our neighbors well, we knock down these divisions, we begin to see a little bit more and more life on earth as it is in heaven. It won't come about by our own strength. It'll only come about by the power of his name and the presence of his Spirit. Are you with me? Let's pray. I think we're out of time. Dear Lord, thanks for it all. Your word, your people, and the presence of your Spirit. The challenge, the assurance, the beauty of who you've called us to be. I pray to be with these folks today as we leave. Help us to live in near and dear and close relationship with you, our great God, and become the genuine people you've called us to be. We ask this by your power, Lord, by your name, Jesus, by your presence, Holy Spirit. Amen.
If you would, go ahead and stand up. Thank you, Matthew. Our God is greater. Asking me. All right. It's good to have you with us, and we want to say goodbye to you. Take the Lord with you. It was sure nice meeting some of the people that hasn't been here before. What a blessing it was. Thank you. Be blessed. One, two, three.